Hello, welcome. How are we doing? So let's get straight into it. The last video we had some issues. And the issues were around runtime type information, RTTI. You can turn it on if you wish, but expect your binaries to explode in size. There is a runtime cost as well. So typically in embedded stuff, we normally don't have RTTI turned on. Because we're much more limited in memory and CPU power and so on. So what we did in that video, using the type index, and this type, actually more importantly, the type ID operator, that is not available when you have RTTI turned off. I thought it was a compile time constant, so that. Or a compile time operator, should I say? So I was slightly bamboozled there, my bad. Now, this is the code we wrote. This is the commit that's up on GitHub that you can find in the description of that previous video. It's quite lengthy, isn't it? So it's not that, it's all of this stuff here, just to get the type information out of there. And although it works if you have RTTI turned on, we're not going to do that. So I actually fixed this off stream or off stream off video, and the link to the fix commit is also in the description of that particular video. So you can either go in at the broken commit and try and fix it yourself if you find that interesting, or you can just skip straight forward to the working code. So there's a couple of bits and bobs I want to get done in this video. It's not going to be hopefully a hugely lengthy video, but we'll see how it goes. I say that often. So we'll talk about the new way that we can implement runtime type information, or at least the functionality that we want, but without RTTI turned on in the compiler. The other two bits I want to do are this attribute value that we have for a row in our table that will hold some information that will be accessible over BLE through the GAT server characteristics, blah 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 words. There is actually a special case of this that we currently cannot handle, and that is where we have a row of the table that doesn't have a value associated to it. This will come out in the wash later down the line when we see it, but we will have quite a few of these, and they're effectively metadata rows. So metadata being data about data. So we will have a row in the table that says the next row is something interesting, and here is some characteristics of it. Shouldn't have used the word characteristic there because that has a specific meaning in BLE. But anyway, yeah, hopefully you get the point. So because that particular metadata row does not actually have data within it, so a like we saw in the last video, a byte array, then that value is going to be null and with length 0. Now we can set t to void and the length will work because we have the size of void and so on, which should all come out as 0. But this static assert will of course fail because it'll be 0. And this new operator in theory should fail. I'm not actually entirely sure whether it does or whether it will return a null pointer. But either way, the rest of it is going to be a little bit broken then with the null pointer side of things. So we need to actually have a special case of this where we want an empty attribute value, not an empty one, a null attribute value that doesn't actually have this byte array within it. But we still want to use the struct because this is effectively our interface into making the table. The last thing that hopefully we can get on to doing is when we make this table, We currently have a few hard-coded values that we just did as a nice little shortcut last video. For example, the UUID here is currently hard-coded to a 16-bit UUID of value 123. Clearly that's wrong, and we've got a nice to-do note there. The permissions of this particular row of the table and the maximum length that the attribute can hold are also hard-coded, so we need to find a way of fixing that so our interface allows us to set these at a higher up level. Okay, so let's dive in. The fix to the runtime type information, I found this really quite nice, elegant fix here. You can see it's just no code at all. It's really sneaky in a way, but also sort of quite clever. So let's just talk about the way it works. First of all, we have a using type, a using declaration here, should I say. And we're going to say that our type ID is a void star, so a void pointer. So for anyone not familiar with the using type, the using operator, this is equivalent to saying type def type ID void star, like that. Have I got that the right way round? No, it's not. It's the other way around, isn't it? I love how they swap that. But that actually makes more syntactic sense to me anyway, because we're declaring something. So anyway, it is what it is. But that's the equivalent. So we're basically saying that this type now, which in theory should have an underscore t, is just a void star. So it's a pointer to an unknown type in memory. And then all the work is actually done by this template class. Now there is a cost associated to this, and we'll talk about that. And this function, should I say, it's template function, not did I say template class, creates a singleton, effectively, a static pointer to the template type, and returns its address. So this is a bit funny to get your head around, actually, but it's so clever. So we effectively make a pointer. It's a null pointer, but that's largely irrelevant. A pointer to a type of the template, and it's static. So there'll only be one of these per type we call this template for. And then we return the address of that pointer. And because there's only one of them per type that we call this function, then that is effectively a unique identifier. The address of that pointer is unique per type. So if we instantiate this with a char, for example, so if we say, let's just do a bit of copy and paste a roo down here in a bit of sudo code. Let's call this with a char. And let's just call it char ID is equal to this. What are we doing here? Well, this is a const for a start. I wonder if that can be const expert. Maybe. I don't think it actually matters. So we are calling this template function, and the template instantiation is with a char. We create a pointer to a char, but the char doesn't exist, doesn't need to. And we assign that null pointer because it has no meaning. It doesn't actually point to anything, but it is a char star. So this becomes a char star. And then we return the address of this char star. Okay. So now, in some other bit of code, we can do, we can have our random thing, and we can just do an if on it. If my thing, and we want, or my type, should I say, clack, clack, clack. So we can do one of them. And we can do char ID. God, come on, what is with my typing today? We can do one of these. No, this is pseudocode, so we're getting the squiggles because I'm outside of a function here. So well, let's just make this a one of those to get rid of the squiggles, so you can hopefully believe me that this works. So if char ID, which we've got as a constant here, is equal to this, let's just do it semi properly, then we know that my type is a char here. Closing braces of template definition not found. Huh? I think that's IntelliSense having a wobble, because that looks valid to me. It's definitely not the static. Anyway, whatever. Excuse me. But anyway, we know this char. And actually, we can cut out the middleman here and get rid of that altogether. And we can just put type ID of char in here, because that will get evaluated. Now, when we come along and try this with a double, just to pluck another example out here, we will get a new template instantiation. It will not be the char one, because we've passed in a different T, a different class, a different type name, whatever. So, when we pass in a double, this will be a completely new instantiation. There'll be a static pointer to a double, and we'll be returning the address of that pointer to a double. And that is then, therefore, the cost. So every time you use this, it's going to cost you 4 bytes, which is the size of a pointer in this in our world on the ESP. But that's how we do it. Hopefully that makes sense. Oh, I've just spotted it. There we go. And that's it. Quite simple, quite elegant. The cost isn't silly. May even get optimized. I'm not convinced it will, because there'll be a runtime dependency on this. So I don't think it'll get optimized. But it should get optimized if we use it in a context per context. So this might actually be const expurable. I'm not sure. Can you do? No, it can't be, because we've got a static. And in C++ 17, you can't have a static inside a const expur function. Yes, that's why. I remember now. I can't remember if you can in C++ 20. Not sure. You might be able to. I think I've read that somewhere. Anywho, then when we come to use this, it's quite straightforward, no? We can do the type ID of a void, so we know this is our equivalent empty definition, which we can, you know, override and set with something else. We can query it like this, and we can do our usual strip the pointer type and so on. So we get a we actually get the underlying type of the thing that we're interested about, because the full down of this, and we could potentially fix it in this class, but I'm not in this function, but I don't particularly like the idea where we could have strip pointer type here, so it always goes to the underlying thing. But the problem with that is then if you actually wanted the type of a the type ID of a char star rather than a char, we might want that, then that will just get deleted away into an underlying char, and therefore a char star will be the same as a char, which isn't really the responsibility of this function. This function just gets me an ID of the type, so it's an equivalent to the type ID operator we saw before. So I would rather strip things out at the point of need, at point of use, I suppose. Okay, cool. So that's that. And this all just flows through, and this builds as well. I can prove that. So while that's building, we need a way of having an attribute value that is empty, that is null. And we can achieve that with a template specialization. There we go, build successful. And this is probably the correct way of doing it. So what we do, and yes, I'm well aware that's a copy and paste, is we get rid of that bit, and then here we say void, like that. So what we're saying is use this template for anything. So for any t we pass in, the optional parameter n elements, so on and so forth, this will just get used. However, if someone does an attribute value void, don't use this, use this one, but only for that special case. Okay, and that means we can have a separate implementation for this special case, and that's exactly what we shall do. And this becomes actually quite easy. So we can just make all of these zero. We can get rid of the static assert because it's it doesn't make sense. We can leave that in. We can leave that as it is, just for maintainability, I guess. The constructor no longer takes anything. And we don't need to initialize the unique pointer, because we can leave that defaulted to an effectively a null pointer under the hood. And then all of this stuff here was to copy the value we passed in into a byte array. Now, we're not actually passing anything in anymore, so there's no copying to do, so that can be deleted. And actually, what we see now is there is nothing in the body of this constructor, so we can actually just get rid of it altogether. We don't need it. And this needs to become void. And we don't need that anymore, so that'll just save us a bit of a compile time. There we go. And this becomes very, very simple. Very nice and easy to use. And now we need to just make sure we've not broken anything down here. So we're passing in a bunch of these attribute values. Now one of them could be void. They are the values in this parameter pack here, so that ultimately becomes an arg in our lambda, as we talked about in the last video. And we effectively copy that into our table. We move the pointer, the unique pointer, should I say, and unique pointers that don't point to anything I'm pretty sure are movable. I don't see why they're not. I must say, I've not actually checked that, but it feels like that would be an oversight if it's not movable. That would be a weird sort of thing to do. So I don't think anything here should break. So let's just give that, obviously this isn't a runtime test or anything, but let's just check that we've done our template specialization, that's what it's called, correctly, which I'm pretty sure we have. But I'm open to surprises. Yep, we have, and that's looking good. Okay, so what time are we on? 20 minutes. Look at that, speeding. Getting good at this. The video making thing, maybe. So the last thing I wanted to cover then, which we do have time for, is to find a way of passing in these, these placeholder constants things that we've done. And that's exactly what I want to do. Now, we still want this to be a parameter pack. That makes sense. But we can't, like, if this was a non-parameter pack function, you know, we could just put UUID here as another thing, and then permissions, and then max len, like that. But we need that for each of the values, and this won't work, because this will actually only attribute itself to the, or the way we've written it, to the last value in the pack that we pass in. And obviously these have types. And the thing is, we will probably want it to be different for each of the values. So that's clearly not going to work. So we need a way of attributing a UUID, a permission, and a max length to each of the values. And you can probably see where this is going. We need a type. We need a struct to contain that. So we can then just pass in each of those structs, and they have all the information that we want within them. And it's just going to be an aggregate struct, we call it here. So we want a, let's just call it a table row type. It's going to have within it a attribute value. How do I want to do this? It's gonna have, we're gonna have to cascade the template down, which is a bit annoying, I have to admit. No, will this work with the defaulted template parameter? I think it will. So that's now just a wrapper around the attribute value. And we also want our UUID in here. And it actually makes sense for that one to be first. Our permissions, I'm pretty sure there's a type for this. Yes, there is. So let's use that. There we go. Permission. And then this is a uint16 val max. Let's just put max len. In fact, it makes sense for that to be val max len. And actually, I want that last. Now, did we look at this last time that there is a IDF version of this MaxLen? I've got a feeling we did and decided not to use it for some reason. Anyway, we can hard code it. It doesn't matter too much. Let's use our define. Why not? We can always come back and change it. I don't like that, but anyway, it is what it is. For now, let's just do a little bit of prettification there. So we now have a struct that contains our UUID, our permissions, the actual value, and the max length, which we'll just set to 20 if not specified. Which might seem wasteful, sort of is a bit, but it's up to the user whether they specify it. So if they're content with everything being max length and taking up a load of, more memory, then that's their call, to be perfectly honest. So what changes now is rather than when we call this function, make table, which now doesn't actually need to be a read-only table because we can get rid of this hard coding. Rather than passing in a load of attribute value types, we're going to pass in a load of table row types. Simple as that. And actually, that makes this a little bit cleaner. I'm just trying to remember what the hell this was. Arg heap. Oh, yeah, there's a bug here, you know. Fill array one. Yeah, well, let's go through it. So we're assuming we're passing in a table row type. This is where C++ requires would be very, very nice. So we can actually specify that TS must be one of these, but we can't do that in 17. There might be a way to do it with type traits. I'm not sure. But in theory, if you don't use this is not going to compile in a minute anyway. So the arg we pass in is just one of the values. So we can do arg dot UUID, and that is going to pull this value out here. And then similarly, arg permissions, or permission, should I say? Arg.maxlen, sorry, val.maxlen. This is bugging me. Because we are default constructing an attribute value of type of the arg. So this isn't getting called because we're calling the default constructor. And then we are copying that data in, which is just default constructed. That's wrong. Yeah? Yeah, it is, isn't it? We don't need that at all. Oh no, wait, hang on a minute. Our ret is a gat table, which is an array of these wrappers. Let's just figure this out between us. Which is fine. I'm thinking wait a minute. Ah, no, I see what I've done. Yeah, it is wrong. Yeah, okay. Because the idea here was to just pass in a char star, an int, a float, blah, blah, blah. Whereas, actually, in fact, no, we can still do that, can't we? Can we? Yeah, because we might as well just propagate through this array type. Yeah, okay. So when we construct this, so let me show you what I mean here. So we're going to make in, let's just create a sudo function here, like that. We're going to make a table row, right? And let's call it row one. And the way we can do that is because it's just an aggregate class, we can pass in a UUID. Wish I hadn't deleted that now. Have I still got that on a tab? No, have I? Let's just do a quick thing so I can copy and paste. In fact, no, I should still have that in a tab. Yes, I have. I've got it here. Yoink. Badink. So let's just stick that in for the moment, because this is sudo code anyway. So we can put our UUID in, our permissions, and some value like that. And this becomes a char, attribute value, using type T, which is a char underlying a char. No, it's not. It's a char array. Oh, so this is where it gets a bit messy if it can't figure out the template type deduction. Which it cannot. So we have to, we can probably do char star and then what's this, 12, isn't it? Hello world. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 for the null terminator. Row one is not a template. Because I'm a dum-dum. There we go. So what this does is we're going to create a table row. It's an aggregate class, so the first in the initializer list is the UUID, then the permissions, then the value, and then because we've not specified it, we'll just get max length for this. And now, and just to be clear then, the constructor, this constructor of this type will get called with that as an argument. So attribute value type, T is a char. It's going to call this constructor, which is going to make us a unique pointer, copy it, the data held in that value, over into that heap allocated managed smart pointer that's managed by the unique pointer there. So all of that, happens under the hood quite nicely in this just one. That's quite nice. I really quite enjoy that. English. So then, when we create our table, we can just pass in a row, and this will be a one row table now. Will it figure that out? No, it will not. So we have to. Oh, actually, no, wait a minute. So, no, it should figure that out. What am I on about? That's perfectly valid. Argument list for alias template. Surely it can figure that out. No? I don't believe you. What if I don't call the assignment? That shouldn't change anything as far as I'm aware. Why is that not? Why is the template argument deduction not working there? Oh. Ah, this is where that falls down. Yeah, so you can't convert a string constant to a char. But I should be able to do that. Yes, I am. But it still doesn't like this. Which is weird because it should do. Because the template argument deduction should figure that out. There we go. Serves me right for saying this was going to be quick. Type value mismatch at argument one. Oh, ha. I'm being a plonker. Oh gosh, who saw this? Who saw this mistake? That's a real weekend mistake, that is, isn't it? I was calling the constructor to the get table, not this function. That's what I was doing wrong there. And this, I think, is correct now. No. What are you moaning about now? Make read-only table was not declared in this scope. No, of course it wasn't, because this needs to be down there. This is why sudo code can be sometimes a real pain in the bum. So, but I do want this to be correct. Our UUID was not declared in this scope. Oh, right, okay, yeah, because we don't need that anymore. Getting that one error at a time. An instantiation of make read only table, blah, 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 required from there. No matching function call to. attribute value. But we don't need that though, do we? Because we're handling that now in the type. So we don't need that at all. Wait, do I need to? Yes, I do. We need to have that statement in here. Ugh, don't like that at all. So the way around that, using underlying type, is that and then this becomes underlying type, which I still don't particularly like, but there we go. Thank you. Let's just refresh these errors. So, no match for operator equals. Arkeep was not declared in this scope. No, because we don't need it. I'm sure there was a reason for doing that, and I've completely forgotten now, so this might come back and bite me. Structure has no member len bytes. No, because that is within val. Yeah, might need to fix some of this naming, because that's starting to get silly. You don't see this. So required from here, use the deleted function. Unique pointer. The default deleter. Because that is const, and we can't move out of a const. How did that compile before? So what the issue there was we were taking the argument in by as const, const ref, but anyway, const. And then trying to move out of it. You can't move out of a const smart pointer. Makes no sense, because you need to change the underlying pointer, the original pointer, to null. Or null pointer, effectively. In order to move out of it. Or move the data it holds to somewhere else. But you can't change it to null pointer because it's const. So that has to be non-const, of course. So that looks like the sort of thing we want to do now. And of course, you know, we want multiple of these. Row 2, row 3. And let's just have 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 5, just to prove a point. 1, 2, 3. like that. And then, actually, I wonder if well, CTAD work now. Oh, it's not CTAD. Template argument deduction doesn't look like it. Let's just double check it's not an IntelliSense thing. No, it's not. It doesn't like that. Cannot deduce template arguments as it has no viable deduction guides. We might be able to fix that, but I don't think we can without doing one for every type going, which is obviously not going to happen. So let's stick an int in there and let's stick a float in there. We know what the float's got to be. 3.14. Happy Pi Day for the other day as well. And the int has got to be 69, hasn't it? Let's go full maturity mode here. Let's just double check that works. So now we've got, we've created three rows. And these will all exist on the heap now. And then we can just copy and paste these. Let's say copy and paste. We can move these into our new table, which will now have three rows in it. One containing a const char star. Well, yeah, effectively. But an array of chars. That is incorrect. Let's just... Can we tidy this up a bit? Like that. There we go. So yeah, one contains an array of chars. I.e. a C string. One contains an integer, one contains a float. Notice these are all different types here. But because of the way we've done the table, that works perfectly fine. And out the back of it, we get a table where all of these rows are combined. So effectively, what we're doing is we're creating an array of length 3. Which is row 1, row 2, row 3. Like that. But of course you can't do it this way because it has to have a single type. And they don't. They've all got different types. So the type is the whole thing highlighted there, which is clearly different to that. It's not just this bit. So you can't do it that way. So that's why we've had to use our clever little mechanism for converting everything into byte arrays. So then they do have all the same type, effectively. But we also store using that clever type ID workaround. We store what it actually was originally. So we can still query it and get stuff out of there. And I'm pretty sure that works. So let's tidy up some of the unnecessary stuff. And it's always really satisfying when you simplify code and it becomes much, much shorter. This now is really quite nice and short, which makes it easier to maintain, easier to read and reason about. We don't need that anymore because that was just pseudocode. Let's just change some of this naming so it's a little bit more nicer, a little bit nicer on the eye. That's still not good. Is there a way I could tidy that up? Probably not. TI I don't like at all. type. Let's do that. I know that conflicts there, but I prefer it to just TI marginally. Don't need to change anything else. And then that, have I changed that in everywhere that it's used? I have. Excuse me. So TI means nothing. So if someone comes in and goes, oh, how's the table made? What's this value that's passed in called TI? That makes no sense. Type ID. Ah, okay, I see. They might be doing some sort of type erasure under the hood. And then they can, you know, just F3 into that. Or not, as the case may be. Whatever. So we've tidied that up. This is now looking better. It compiles. We still need to test, you know, it works, but we can't do that until we've got all the rest of the BLE stuff done. But we have tested this in Compiler Explorer, pretty much. At least all the heavy lifting that happens under the hood. And I think I put the links to that in the previous video description as well. So you can have a play with that. A little bit harder to do on Compiler Explorer because we are coupled to the IDF with these type names. You quite often see people will do workarounds for that. So a using or a type def, but using, for example, my UUID type is equal to that, and do that for all of the things down the row, and then you use your type here. But this means that you only need to swap out this definition there into something else. So if we don't have access to this header, which we don't on Compiler Explorer, we can say, you know, this is an int of 2 or something like that. Bad example, that's not correct. But you just swap out all of these that are at the top of your file. There is a lot of people do that. In fact, I'd probably say the majority of professional sort of people do that. I've never liked it. It works, it's right, it is the right thing to do within reason, but I still don't like it. So if I don't have to do it, I won't. So that's just pretty much done, I think. Oh, do I really want to do all of this? Go on, let's do it. Let's make it look a little prettier since we've done it everywhere else. There. Yeah, okay, cool. So I shall upload this code to GitHub. The commit will be down in the description, as always. We should probably rename this to make table from rows. Which, you know, sort of implies this. And let's just put a little contract in there as a note to ourselves, so when I inevitably forget this for the next video, I remember what we're trying to pass into this. And we're winning. So next video, we will look at actually making the table proper so passing the arguments in that the IDF expects. So we'll have to dive into how the IDF expects those rows to be. So you've already had a slight hint towards some of them are metadata rows and contain no value but have some information about the following thing. So we'll implement that so we can then actually build our first GAT server table from a bunch of rows. We'll probably have to do an intermediary of building a characteristic first. That makes a little bit more sense. And then from there, we can make the table from characteristics. So this function's going to evolve. We'll probably leave this one in. So you've got a, I can do it manually if I want to, but we'll probably have another function that's make table from characteristics. And those characteristics can be, you know, notifications, they can be read-only, they can be read-write, and so on and so forth. So look forward to that. Appreciate any comments down below, and see you in the next one.